I want to say good morning, giving all praises to my Lord and Savior, Pastor Lavergne, ministers, pastors. At this time, I do want to acknowledge our visitors, if we have any this morning. If not, what a mighty God we serve.
That's
you know,
right.
He's so worthy to be praised today. Yeah. And you know, when I think about, you know, the things that happened in my life, and God saved me, y'all, because I called on him one day.
God is real, y'all. Yes,
he
don't
believe it. He's real.
Yes,
because
he
I was real low, y'all.
Yes,
I'm just,
yes.
You know, Pastor, if you don't mind me saying this,
I was low, y'all.
I almost gave up on life.
Yes.
And that's my testimony.
Mm-hmm.
And I know God is real.
Yes, he is.
He truly is. And he loves us today, y'all.
Yes,
and
he
didn't know that.
Amen.
God is
real.
Amen.
Normally we come up to the front of the church, but circumstances has deemed that we just stand where we are. Chosen than silver. The highway of the upright is to depart from evil. He that keepeth his way preserveth his soul. Pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Better is it to be of a humble spirit with the lowly than to bind the spoil with the proud. He said, he that handleth a matter wisely shall find good. And whosoever trusts in the Lord, happy is he. I don't know about you today, but I'm going to be happy. I'm tired of running around here with a sad face all the time. Always with a dark cloud on my head. I don't know about you, but today, I'm glad to be happy. See, this morning when the Lord woke me up, kept my body still warm, I was happy. They said when we get up, we're in a war with the devil. I got up this morning with my feet in the floor this morning. I was happy. I said, I'm going to ride on down the road this morning. I'm going to OBC this morning. I got happy all the way. I listened to my gospel music all the way here. Thank you, Jesus. See, because last night I had some bad thoughts in my mind. Last night I had some pure thoughts in my heart. But see, God worked it out for me this morning. I got into that secret closet. I called on the Lord. He fixed it. See, he fixed it for me. He'll fix it for you. So you got to be happy. Don't let nobody steal your joy. Father God, as we come this morning, thank you once again for your grace and your mercy. Father God, I personally thank you for my happiness this morning. Father God, I thank you for just blessing me to see another day. Father God, not to be selfish or anything, I thank you for everybody that's assembled here in your church house this morning, Heavenly Father. Father God, if they not happy when they came in here, I ask that you bless them to be happy when they leave here, Heavenly Father. Father God, I ask that the preached word reach their souls, oh, Heavenly Father. Reach deep down inside their body, oh, Heavenly Father. Give them happy feet, oh, Heavenly Father. They can go out and tell somebody else what thus said the Lord this morning, Heavenly Father. Father God, we ask that you remove all of the hate and the deceit out of people's hearts this morning, Heavenly Father. Father God, build them up, Heavenly Father, where they may be torn down, Heavenly Father. Father God, as I said, if somebody tries to steal their joy, Heavenly Father, I ask that you bless them. Bless the ones that are trying to take the joy, oh Heavenly Father. Bless them to change their hearts and minds this morning, Heavenly Father. Father God, you said, we call on you, the devil will flee, oh Heavenly Father. When we call on you this morning, oh Heavenly Father. Father God, we give you the highest praise, glory, hallelujah. Some serious battles down in the schools, Father God. Oh God, we ask that you bless them, Heavenly Father. Keep on keeping on, Heavenly Father. Let them know it ain't just about the sports, Heavenly Father. But they down there to get an education, Heavenly Father. Where they can be better grown-ups when they get out of that school, Heavenly Father. Father God, we know that everybody ain't down there for our babies, Heavenly Father. Father God, we ask that you remove them, remove their seeds away from our kids, Heavenly Father. Father God, we ask that you protect them, oh Heavenly Father. Protect them from the dangers that are crowding in inside the schools, Heavenly Father. Protect them from the dangers already in the schools, oh Heavenly Father. Yeah. Father God, we thank you, Heavenly Father. We know that you got some angels down there walking up and down those hallways also, Heavenly Father. Father God, let them speak peace into our children while they're down at those schools, oh Heavenly Father. Father God, we ask that you speak peace to our kids at their homes, oh Heavenly Father. Distractions to others, oh Heavenly Father. Father God, we ask that you bless the city of Shady in this morning, Heavenly Father. Get the ones traveling grace that are on their way to the church house this morning, Heavenly Father. Give us all traveling grace as we leave here today, oh Heavenly Father. Father God, we ask that you continue to bless each and every one of Heavenly Father. They woke up this morning, they had a hangover, or a headache, high blood pressure, cancer, whatever it is, Heavenly Father. We call it out. Heavenly Father, fix them, oh Heavenly Father. Shake them up, wake them up, Heavenly Father. Whatever it is that keep them from loving you and praising you, Heavenly Father, we ask that you take it away from them, oh Heavenly Father. Just like you took the drugs and alcohol away from you, Heavenly Father, to take it away from everybody, Heavenly Father, that's using it. Father God, I ask that you bless the drug addicts that are walking up and down this highway. This highway, oh Heavenly Father. Father God, I ask a special prayer that you shake my daughter this morning, Heavenly Father. Shake the dope out of her body this morning, Heavenly Father. Let her know that I ain't gonna be here forever, Heavenly Father. She called on me never, Heavenly Father. I ain't gonna be here one day. She ain't gonna better call me, Heavenly Father. But I ask that you put in her heart to call on you, Heavenly Father. Turn to you, Heavenly Father, that you got her and she follows the steps of the one to go, Heavenly Father. Not only my child, Heavenly Father, but everybody's child out there suffering right now. Whatever that disease, whatever that addiction might be, Heavenly Father, I ask that you call it out, Heavenly Father. Touch
19 to 25. It's actually we're going to probably cover all the way up to 30, but verses is 19 to 25. Amen. Come on, dear.
Say, but I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timotheus shortly unto you.
Amen.
That I also may be of good comfort when I know your state. For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. Mm-hmm. For all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ.
Yes.
But ye know the proof of them, that as a son with a father,
yes,
he has served with me in the gospel.
All right.
Him therefore I hope to send presently, mm-hmm, so soon as I shall see how it will go with me.
Yes.
But I trust in the Lord that I also myself shall come shortly.
Mm-hmm.
Yet I suppose it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother,
yeah,
and companion in labor, and fellow soldier, but your messenger and he that ministered to my wants.
Amen.
Amen. Ooh. Amen. Just for a moment, I want to talk on this subject. Men of faith.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. And I'm not excluding the women. We'll just look at this as covering both of them.
Amen.
Men of faith. I can say men and women of faith. But Paul here, in the gospel, calls it men of faith. Let us pray. Eternal God, we come this morning, and the only way we know how to worship, to praise, and to acknowledge and uplift the word that you have given us. Father, I pray that you would take me right now and put me behind the cross, that there be more of you and less of me. These things I pray. We're going to continue our thought this quarter, which is a partnership with purpose.
Amen.
Partnership with purpose. We have partners, girlfriend, all those things, but there's one or two special that you have a partnership with purpose where you not only call each other and talk, but you call and you ask about the mothers and the fathers, you pray for them, and occasionally you will join in with them at a neutral place or even at their house, whether it's in Tunis, whether it's in L.A., the other L.A., Louisiana, whether it's Boston, Massachusetts, South Carolina, North Carolina, wherever it is, you have friends with purpose, and you are faithful to those friends. They know just about when something is bothering you or trouble is on their mind. Hello, somebody. When you will call and pray for them. So this morning, in our lesson, 2 points, and I'm gonna sit down. The first one was, Timothy was a committed servant.
Right.
Now in this lesson, Paul sent Timothy, as Timothy, that's Timothy.
Okay.
And he sent Epaphroditus.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Check on him, amen?
All right.
So these two men were called men of faith. See, he encouraged the church to embrace these men and benefit from their presence. Hello, somebody. Mm-hmm. You know, when we have a visitor, pastor, or minister here, and we give them all the attention that you would give to your pastor.
Right.
But these two men, they amplify commitment Christian service. Mm-hmm. I was talking about this morning in Sunday school, that we need those who will invest in others.
Right.
We've been all selfish with our time, our places, and our treasures. Amen? So we need to examine who will invest in others, impacting the life of Christ.
Amen.
Now, here in our text this morning, Paul was planning. But following the great discourse on the obedience of Christ to the will of the Father and our obligations to possess the mind of Christ,
okay,
that comes from the Bible, Paul offered yet another example of faithful Christian service. So here he did something I thought that was amazing. When you are a man of faith or a woman of faith, he makes an announcement that Timothy and Epaphroditus will soon be making visits to Philippi.
Huh.
Now, you know, Philippians is one of those prison ministries.
Right.
Paul was writing from prison, a prison in Rome.
Yeah.
And now, every year we have a revival. You know, sometimes our spirituality and our worship and our love sort of dwindle during the year. So revivals are to uplift you and get you back in to serve.
All right.
Revival is simply revive your faith in God. So like the Lord they served, these men, they were great examples of committed Christian service. As the Philippians read this letter, they must have realized that they would soon have a devout man to model a lifestyle of commitment after.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
There's churches today since that pandemic that are not yet open. But those that are, that live in the faith of God,
amen,
know that he will cover us.
All right.
We don't have to be foolish people, but we just need to be careful.
Yes, sir.
Who and where and what we are involved in. Okay? So, while our culture and needs are somewhat different, but we too are blessed with those who live out their faith before others.
Okay.
Amen. I'm hoping that someone
all right
can see the Lord
oh, yeah
in us. Hello, somebody. Amen. They provide a godly example of how Christians' service should look. So while they're here, hopefully they'll leave with the impression that I've had service with some faithful Christians.
Right.
Some service, because the Lord himself said, I came to serve. Not to be served, Sister Jackson, but I came to serve. And it was baffling to the people that heard this at their church service.
All right.
But every mature believer ought to share this desire.
Mm-hmm.
Hello, somebody.
All right.
And striving to be present as a godly example for young believers to follow.
Amen.
I remember when I was a little kid, my daddy's boots and shoes, you know, I couldn't wait till he took them off. I'd go right around, right behind him. I'd get in those big old shoes and flop around the house, you know, because I wanted to stand in my father's shoes. Because he was a good example of a godly man. Now, he wasn't always that way. But at a time when the Lord took all of his habits and all of his wickedness, and he called him, and then he answered that call. And I remember him taking me to church every Sunday and every Wednesday. He was a servant in the church and in the community. And I could not understand that as a young kid and going up to teenager, that every Saturday morning, talking about every Saturday morning,
mm-hmm,
he would wake me up 5:30 in the morning and say, get the lawnmowers. Put him in the car, in the truck. And we go around and he cut his sister's yard, he'd go and cut the church's yard, and he cut his cousin's yard, and we spent almost the whole day cutting other people's yard.
Yeah.
And I'm tired, I'm like that. And he never received or accepted a penny from them.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't understand it. But I understand it today. Amen. a faithful servant. You know, and I can remember his sister, amen, she just come to the door and she smiled, you know, like that. She was much older than my dad. That was a big sister. But the Lord can change anybody. Right. Hello?
Oh, yeah.
He can change anybody. But Timothy and Epaphroditus was on their way to the Philippian church.
Come on.
Right. That's good news. That's good news.
Right.
Paul had what you would call trust in them. He knew because those were his sons in the ministry. Hello, somebody. They knew that as the Philippians read this letter, they must have realized they would soon have a devout man to model a life of committed service and obedience. But you say, but while living faithfully for the Lord, these provide a means of discipleship that cannot be underestimated. Hello, somebody? Sometimes you wonder if what you're standing up preaching, if it reaches anybody's heart. Mm-hmm. Amen. But first of all, it had to reach my heart to be able to share it with you.
All right.
I'm just not taking a scripture. But as I think of and read it, and the Lord put it on my heart to share with you. So, as we look at this chapter, we want to talk about the expectation of Paul for the church as we look at committed men of faith.
All right.
First of all, that first subject that I want to talk about is Timothy, a committed servant. Here in verse 19 to 24, no doubt, he says, that the church was familiar with Timothy. Mm-hmm. He had served faithfully among them with Paul. Paul, on his missionary journey, he started the church in Philippi. Now, Paul reminds them of the commitment that Timothy possessed. You know, when you invite a preacher to come into your church, that you have to feel like they are anointed preachers. And they're not going to stand up here and mislead you in the word of God. Mm-hmm. Hello, somebody.
All right.
But he encouraged them of the benefit of his presence. Mm-hmm. You know. And there was an arrangement made here. In verse 19, he said, but I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy shortly unto you. He was making an arrangement, and he said that I also may be of good comfort when Timothy comes, when I know that I'm sending him, when I know his estate, and I know your condition also. So Paul makes a plan. He said, but I trust in the Lord Jesus to send you my loved one, Timothy. And he's coming shortly unto you. In the name of Jesus and in his name, the servant of Jesus Christ.
All right.
Paul had every intention of sending Timothy to serve among them as soon as possible. You know, sometimes churches are in trouble. They're in a mess. They're in a state of confusion. They don't have a pastor. They don't have a spiritual leader or anyone that will step up and take that responsibility upon themselves. But he knew Timothy would serve. They were encouraged to anticipate the coming in the near future.
Well,
I remember when old Bethlehem did not have a pastor. When our pastor left and went to another church. And for a moment there was no preacher or pastor here to share the word of God with me. But there were men calling me every Sunday. They were calling the phone in my office saying that they're coming to preach at Old Bethlehem. No invitation. They just called and demanded in a way that I was coming. I said, did you talk to the deacons? They said, no, I'm coming. Well, at the time, I was just humble and tell them that, okay. But in my heart, I already knew the situation. Amen, I already knew it. But I was green, and when they started calling, all I could say was okay. I had not been in a pastorship, so I didn't know what exactly to say. But okay, I'm coming. But the purpose of these men coming, he said, but I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy shortly unto you, that I also may be of good comfort when I know your state. That Paul is not implying that he doesn't trust the reports he is receiving from Philippi, but having Timothy present at the church, that he further affirmed their prosperity in the gospel. Our theme for this month is a partnership with purpose.
Well,
there was purpose that Paul sent them. Paul was planning to send Timothy because he had no other avenue of service. He was sending him with purpose. Hello, somebody. Y'all say purpose.
Purpose.
Purpose. Purpose. Well, see, so I was reminded of the need for every believer to be active and contributing to the work of the gospel. Hello, somebody. See, we have been placed within this local body with purpose. There's things to be done. It's not just the pastor on my chest, but it is the purpose in my heart. Hello, somebody. That I can do something that contributes to the worship and the faith of others. Hello, somebody. I'm almost through, y'all.
Go ahead.
I'm going to let y'all go. See, but there was an agreement also that Paul made. It says here in verse 20 and 22, he said, here we find the agreement Paul and Timothy enjoy. What you talking about, Pastor? Which would serve to further benefit the church. So Paul now, he speaks up a little loud. We know Paul loved the church at Philippi because he, on his missionary journey, stopped and started the church.
Yes, sir.
So, Paul talks about Timothy's character. The character of a man. For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state.
Well,
so, such devotion called for careful selection in the replacement. He didn't want to send just anybody, but he wanted to send somebody that was with him when he started the church at Philippi.
Trying to help out.
In their character. So, Paul could think of only one who shared his heart and vision for the church. And that was Timothy. So Paul and Timothy were like-minded, sharing the same burden for the church.
All
right. Hello, somebody. And the same approach in ministry. That's why I am careful who I invite into this pulpit.
Right.
There are some that I have met and I could not understand and would not trust them with a word in my church.
Mm-hmm.
Because their lifestyle before and explain themselves. You know, you can talk to somebody and just about figure out where their head is as a Christian, as a worshiper, as a believer. You can talk to someone and the Lord said that we have to be equally yoked spiritually.
Amen.
And said you try the spirit
by
the spirit. Hello, somebody. So you will be able to see or hear for yourself that, man, I don't know anybody in the bunch here. Not the way he talking. He ain't talking like a, he ain't talking like no believer.
Yeah.
You know, me and my wife went to a service several years ago, and we were sitting in the back talking to a friend of hers. And while we were sitting there, a man walked up to the pulpit. And when the young lady saw him, she said to us, "He is a preacher? I would never believe that he was a preacher." She said, "I work for, what's the place? The other one. Home Depot." She said, "I work for Home Depot." He said, "That man come in the store raising hell almost every day." She said, "I never would have thought he was a preacher." So your actions and your lifestyle will define you as a believer.
Amen.
But some of us are afraid to minister. Some of us are afraid to approach people when they're out in the public. But wherever you are, the Spirit of the Lord is there with you. Hello? You know, you've confessed your sins, and now you are a new person in Christ. So you don't have to say a word. Your eyes see the word. But it's you that have to put it in action.
Right.
Hello, somebody.
All
you know, when you speak to someone and you walk by and say, "How you doing today?" They look at me. "How you doing?" I say, "I'm doing great." "Well, I ain't doing that great."
"What's so good about it?"
"I ain't doing that so good." So what seems to be bothering you? And then they start to confess what. There's been times where I stopped and I just prayed for a person. Because you can see that dark look on their face. But then we're talking about the arrangement, and it says here in chapter 20, you know, that Timothy's character, he said, "For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state." Back on track. Paul loved the church at Philippi, and he longed to be with them again. Sitting in that Roman prison there is where he's writing this.
Yeah.
Such devotion called for careful selection. So Paul was unable to come himself, so he sent two of his servants, his assistant ministers in the church, to the church of Philippi.
Right.
So finding a few good believers, see, we need to celebrate those relationships naturally, them for the achievement of the church.
All right.
You know, you say, well, Timothy now comes with commitment. He said, "For all seek their own." Hello, somebody. Have not the things which are Jesus Christ. But that 22nd verse says, but ye know the proof of him. Here in the Bible it says that as a son with the Father, he had served with me in the gospel. Telling Paul was telling that Timothy was a committed believer. Paul knew he had to be careful when selecting someone to lead the church. Not just anybody. But all comes to a head when the deacons call me for a meeting. And I had no idea what they was calling me about. But they wanted to meet with me. Now here I am, getting ready. I want to leave and follow my pastor. I did. But before he left, he said, I have already, Robert, recommended you to the deacons. And they gonna call you. They did. And I went in before all these old deacons. Deacon Blake, you know, Bubba Blake, Deacon Amos, that was my alma mater. Deacon Amos. Seemed like the Lord put us together before I even knew anybody in tunes. And when we met together, they asked me to be the pastor of Old Bethlehem. And my response was, no, I'm not ready to be a pastor. They say, well, just think about it. I say, all right, I'll think about it. So I'll pray about it. So I called my pastor nervously and told him that I had talked to the deacon board. And I said, Pastor, I'm not ready to be no pastor. He said, yes, you are, Robert. He said, I know. I wouldn't have recommended you. He said, you're needed here. Well, I said, I've been needed over there too. Wherever you going? But that was his word. And I knew right then and there why he was picking me up every Saturday morning and taking me to meet men of faith. And as I look back upon it, Rev, I realized that he was preparing me for the battle ahead. Hello, somebody. You ever been in that position where you just knew you was going into a battle? You was going in an actual boss for a raise. I ain't got a raise in 5 years. To actual boss for more than a day off. And I have a couple of weeks off. Can I remember the time when I faced problems in my marriage because I was not in line with the Lord? My house was a mess. So whatever it was, he said, you're ready, Robert. I thought about those times we spent together. The ordinance of the church, all of the functions, the programs, all of the mission statements. So Paul was confident in Timothy. He knew he was committed to the Lord. Not gonna send you to pray for someone when I know you don't even pray for yourself. You never say anything about the Lord. You never say he's blessed me or anything. I'm not gonna send you to see another believer with that type of attitude. So how he had proven that among them as he served alongside of Paul. See, our church are filled with those who are content to attend, but do not have the well-being of the church in mind. Hello, somebody. Others desire to obtain a position of authority, but they desire that position to advance their agenda instead of the will of God. Hello, somebody. They quiet this morning, Reb. I'm running. I don't feel like I'm getting there. So we need to continue to serve the Lord faithfully, proving their commitment to the Lord and the church before others. Hello, somebody. We have meetings. With the church members, we have a beginning of the year meeting and the end of the year meeting where you can find out all the things that's going on in the church for that quarter, from December to June, from June to January. We'll know what we're doing in the future. Hello, somebody. And they do not disregard anyone in the church is able to come to that meeting.
All right.
And know what's going on. And you can have a say-so in the matters that go on. Now, Paul in verse 23 and 24, he talks about the announcement. Here, Paul reveals his plan for future visits to Philippi. All right. And now, an immediate plan in verse 23 came. He said, therefore I hope to send presently, so soon as I shall see how it will go with me.
All right.
Meaning that if it's not on my heart, if it's not on my will, if it's not by the word of God, from me, then I will not send you there.
Okay.
Well,
I got to be careful who I send to the hospitals and to members' house to preach for them in times of need or sickness. Mm-hmm. So at that time, Paul was making preparations to send Timothy to Philippi. And it was as soon as possible. This was all contingent on his personal needs. But Paul clearly had the welfare of the church in mind. That was his worry from the beginning. As soon as he got word that there was trouble in the Philippians church, then he knew he had to send someone capable and like-minded as Christ. First of Paul, and then Christ. Clearly. See? And he was doing all he could for their benefit.
Well,
hey, hello, somebody. I'm almost through. So here, in verse 24, he said, but I trust in the Lord that I also myself shall come shortly. Now, he's sitting in the jailhouse, but he's going to come shortly because he has the faith that God's going to deliver him from this prison.
There you go.
Hello, somebody.
There you go.
I don't care. He was sitting there in chains.
Yeah.
But he was already planning to visit them. They said, it will be soon. So if you confess with your mouth and you believe it in your heart, then the Bible says, then it will come to pass.
Wait.
Hello, somebody. I got to leave you now. But Epaphroditus was the other man, the other preacher that he was sending.
All right.
And this is called a compassionate friend. Yeah. Verses 25 to 30. Mm-hmm. But I'm just going to cover 25 and I'm going to let y'all go. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I can hear on that rim. I can hear. Yeah, I can hear that time. See? But this was an optimistic plan. See, in 24, he said, but I trust in the Lord that I also may share myself shall come shortly. Mm-hmm. Encouragement.
Yeah.
Hello, somebody. Knowing, anticipation, knowing that your pastor had been in jail and he's coming home.
All right.
And when he get out, he's coming to see us. So although Paul faced an uncertain future, being bound in Rome, he never lost his desire to return to the Philippian church.
Right.
His love and his devotion for the church never wavered. You know how you start off hot when you first join the church, man? You're so excited. you get on the board, you serve, man, faithfully. Then after a couple of months or so, you start being missing. And that fire has dwindled, that you seem like you just can't reignite that flame. But Paul here was facing uncertainty for his future.
Right.
But then Paul mentioned Epaphroditus.
Right.
He was a compassionate friend, Paul called him.
Yeah.
In that 25th verse to the 30th verse. But following his reminder to Timothy's faithfulness and future plans for his ministry, Paul speaks of Epaphroditus. He said that I also made an agreement with Epaphroditus to come to you also, another assistant pastor in his church. And he made an agreement. Mm-hmm. He said, yet I suppose it necessary to send you Epaphroditus also. Mm-hmm. You know, my brother and compassion in labor, he called him. Now, that's real reassuring when you're sitting there reading this letter from your pastor, knowing the condition he was in. Mm-hmm. Yet he sends you a compassionate person.
Yeah.
He said, my brother and companion in labor and the fellowship are fellow soldiers, but your messenger and he that ministered to my wants.
Yeah.
Hello, somebody. I know things. I know things. Pastors know things when they have created or when they have involved commissioning other preachers or membership to do some compassionate work. Hello, somebody. So prior to Timothy being sent, Paul was going to send Epaphroditus right away. Now, he too was a man they knew as trusted.
Yeah,
he was a brother in faith.
Yeah.
He had labored alongside of Paul, being faithful to stand with him when others was unwilling. Mm-hmm. Hello, somebody. Yeah. He had ministered to the Philippian church, apparently preaching the gospel unto them as the messenger. So Epaphroditus was also there at the Philippian church when Paul commissioned him. Amen? So while Timothy and Paul's presence would have been beneficiary to them, there was no reason not to use Epaphroditus also. And you know that saying, much prayer, much power. Hello?
Little prayer, little power.
Amen. So we must never assume that the church's ministry rests solely on the gifting and the contributions of one individual. So the work of the gospel is greater than any of us. Hello, somebody. Well, I'm thankful to share in the work, but it will go on without me or without you. 156 years or 57? 156? That's what we celebrated last year? Or
157?
156. Amen. This little church is 156 years old. And big church. This big church of faith has stood for 156 years old. And I know there's been many times when somebody that said power in the church will threaten them to leave if they don't get their way. And many of them has left the church. But here we are today, witnessing that The church will go on no matter with you or without you. Know something about it?
Amen.
I just knew the church couldn't go on without Pastor Ross. You know, that was my mindset at the time when he told me. But here's the affection, and I'm going. The affection, verse 26 and 27. He said, for he longed after you all and was full of heaviness. Why, Pastor? Because that ye had heard that he had been sick.
Yeah.
27 says, for indeed he was sick, not unto death. Hello, somebody. Say, all sickness is not unto death. But there's sometimes you get news that will ruffle your feathers. Hello, somebody.
All right.
Well, I remember when the Lord said I had, when the doctor said I had cancer, and I had an aggressive cancer, and I needed to come in right now.
All right.
Because it was so aggressive. And when I got to know the news, even though I was a young believer, the news just wiped out that faith I had in Christ and looked at the news that I had cancer.
Yeah.
But then I went to another believer, hello somebody,
right,
and I told them that I'd just been diagnosed with cancer and I wasn't going to be able to finish out the responsibility of singing in the choir. And I'm so glad I went to a believer, and the believer looked in my eyes and said, Robert, where's your faith? And when he said that, the light came on. And I realized that I wasn't afraid of the word cancer. When they sent me the same day to the hospital, they had no room in the ear. But they found me a little spot among all the prisoners. Hello, somebody. And when I woke up the next morning, I was walking down the hall, and I realized that there was a policeman at every door. And as I got to the nurse's station, hello, somebody, the nurses looked at me and said, I don't know how you can be so happy. What you say? All you doing is smiling at the news of cancer. Your operation. But I knew then, and I prayed then, when they told me that I was going to have treatment for my cancer.
Again,
they came to me one night, and the doctor's lying around the bed and said, Robert, you're going to have to take chemotherapy and radiation.
What?
And I looked at him and said, I told I had a talk with somebody last night that assured me I will not have to take chemo and radiation.
All right.
And they looked at me and said, Robert, I'm going to send in the doctors that's going to give you radiation treatment.
What'd you say?
But I told them I didn't need them to come. But I believe that my body would be healed in the name of Jesus Christ.
All right.
So the next morning, church, the doctors came to the foot of my bed, and they picked up my chart and said, Robert, it seemed like you have no purpose in heaven, radiation or chemo.
Okay.
I don't know what happened last night, but your chart said something differently. So I went through that 6 hour surgery. And they took two patches of skin off my leg and they put it on my shoulder. And I just knew that something wasn't right. My leg was burning, but my wound was feeling all right. That patch of And she was standing there with the director. And she said, baby, I'm coming to get you. I'm going to bring you home so I can work you back. Work you back. And I looked at my mother and I said, Mother, I've made a commitment to this service, to this sinner, and to myself. That I was going to complete my purpose for coming here. And my mama looked at me and said, how are you going to take care of yourself? Because what they did then, they had secured my arm here. And I had 84 stitches there where they grafted the skin. And I had some choir members standing in the background. And they said, Miss Lavergne, don't worry about nothing. They was my roommates. They said, we'll take care of you on this journey.
Man.
Of healing. Hello, somebody.
Amen.
So every morning I got up like Richard Kimmel. And I got dressed and I did all I could do. And my roommates were sitting on their bed, anticipating needing help from me. But I did all I could, and they would do the rest.
Man.
Put my shirt on and my shoes on, I couldn't tie them. See, so that was friends. Well, and I finished my commitment. When I finished it, I was ready to go back into the world.
All right.
Uh-huh. But the Lord had healed me. When I didn't have to have radiation chemotherapy.
All right.
And I was about to finish this program. And I was talking to another. And I told him that I was about to leave. And I was sending my resume to several companies. And at that time, the boss came over walking by the table. And he stopped and he turned around. And he said, Robert, you about to finish? I said, yes, sir. And he went on about his business. And the next morning, right after church, they called me on the loudspeaker. Hello, somebody.
Right.
I know some of you heard this story, but I got to tell it again. He called my name on the loudspeaker. And usually, when they call your name, it seems like trouble is right behind it. But when he called me about 8:30 that morning, I sit in that lobby. And I sit there, and lunchtime came, and the guy said, go eat lunch, Robert, come back. I came back, and I sit there, and about 3 o'clock, I said, man, what's up? He said, just sit down, Mr. Board, come in and talk to you. So I was sitting there, and it came about 4:30, I saw my boss fixing to exit the building. So I said, yo, get past the board, and tell him I'm still waiting for him. So he came back, and he said, oh, Robert, I'll talk to you in the morning. So again, the next morning after church, they called me on the loudspeaker. And I went to the booth and said, Rob, Mr. Boyd, I want to talk to you. Have a seat. So now here's those unbelievers, all right? They walking by and say, man, you must be in trouble. Because you keep me sitting here. You don't keep nobody sitting here if they're not in trouble. But you know what I did? I did an inventory of myself.
All right.
Anybody hear me this morning? I did an inventory of myself. And I knew I followed all the rules. I went to all the meetings. And for one time in my life, I knew I hadn't done nothing wrong.
All right.
And I sit there that next morning till lunchtime, and the guy said, I was Robert going to lunch. I went to lunch, came back. I said, well, where's Mr. Boy? He said, just sit down, have a seat. I sit down. 2 o'clock came. 3 o'clock came, nothing. I went to, I said, man, what? He said, just sit down, Mr. Boy, and talk to him. So, 4:30, I saw Mr. Boy to head for the exit. So I said, man, holler at Mr. Boy and tell him I've been waiting for him. So he came back. 2 days, he came back and said, oh, Robert, I'm sorry. He said, come on back. I went to his office. And as soon as I sit down, this big 6'11" guy was standing on my shoulder. Like, where he came from? This is our choir director. So Mr. Boyd said, Robert, I just wanted to know if you'd be interested. We have a position here, and I just wondered if you would be interested. I'm like, be interested. I said, I'll take it. I don't care what it is. He said, I'll see you before you go. It was the 4th of July weekend. I was headed to Louisiana. He said, I'll let you know. So as I walked through the building, I could see him sitting in the cubicle there. And when he saw me, he did this. Thumbs up. That meant I got it. Hello, sir.
Amen.
And I got a job. I didn't have to go out and look for it. And the Lord chose to keep me just where I was.
Yep.
He said, I'm not through with you yet. He said, I need you to be on the other side now.
All right.
You've been homeless, but I want you to be on the other side. And what you going to do about the homeless? What you going to do about the veterans? What you going to do about their soul? What you going to do about their ministry? And I'm like, thank you, God. So I went home that 4th of July, walk in. I couldn't wait to tell my mother. You know, I didn't tell nobody at the place. I kept it all to myself. And I went home, and my mother said, baby, what you going to do with your life? I said, Mom, I got a job. She said, you do? I said, yes, ma'am. She said, where? I said, I'm working in the same place I went to be renewed.
Amen.
I'm working at the Salvation Army. Hello, somebody. Amen. I had me a job. And my mother just sit there with this look on her face. And just was silent for a minute. She couldn't believe it, you know. But then 20 years ago, I retired in 2019.
Amen.
Hello, somebody. Amen. The same place I was able to minister to the guys that was in the condition that I was in.
Amen.
And my first position was to accommodate the pastors that would be coming in to share the word in the church with the men.
Yeah.
Amen. And then one night, about 20 minutes before church would start, this preacher called me that was supposed to be there. And he said, Robin, can you stand in for me tonight? And at that time, I broke out in a cold sweat. 20 minutes, I said, yes, sir, I will. I hung up the phone. I ran upstairs to my office. And I opened my Bible. And I opened it to where Paul had given his life on the road to Damascus. That's what I just said. So I preached on that. And then I was sweating buckshot the whole time I was preaching. You know, the homeless guys and drug addicts and stuff. See, but they had never seen me on this side.
Yeah.
See, but I sat with them and worshiped with them and prayed with them and ate with them and slept with them before that. Uh-huh. So you see now, when I finish, I'm like, Lord, thank you. Thank you, Lord. And as I stood there, I came down to the pulpit because there was men lining up there. And I went down there and they say, hey, Mr. Lavergne, that was a good service. It really helped me. And that's all I needed to hear, that I could help just one person.
That's right.
He said, just one person led to the gospel. And as I go to my seat, we have to realize that men of faith are placed in position where they may not want to receive it, but they're needed and they're believers. So they have to pray and ask God to take away that old shield of fear in serving him. Hello, somebody. I know a man called Jesus Christ. He didn't care what he was wearing. He didn't care about his shoes. He didn't care about his shirt. He didn't care about his head. All he wanted to do was serve the Lord. All he wanted to do was share the gospel with everyone. And because of his faith, they didn't like him. His old people didn't like him. They said, let's stop by. Where Jesus lived, this little old town called other people. And they did not accept him as a believer. But Jesus, he came and he died for your sins and for mine. Hello, somebody. And they beat him all the way up Calvary's Hill.
Here we go.
Hello, somebody.
Forgive.
They beat him all the way to Golgotha's Hill. He was so tired, he couldn't carry his own cross. But God provided somebody to take his place and carry the cross up to Calvary. And then he got there, his haters laid him flat on the ground. And underneath him was an old rugged cross. And they started to nail his head to the cross. And they nailed his feet also. But then they made a big mistake. They lifted him high. They lifted him high. And it seemed like the spirit started moving. And when he was up there, he was looking down.
Thank you.
Officers and nurses.